let's talk a little bit about, again, insufficiency. So, something is insufficient. So, for a muscle to be declared insufficient, it has to be, number one, a two-joint muscle. A two-joint or multi-joint muscle. So, single-joint muscles are never insufficient. Joint muscles when we're dealing with insufficiency. It's one of the most important things. When we're dealing with insufficiency, it can either be active or passive. So insufficiency can either be active or it can be passive. Think about muscle stretch. So active insufficiency is going to be dealing with muscle contraction. Passive insufficiency will be dealing with muscle stretch. So let's start with the book, and then we'll go into it. It says in a one-joint muscle, the excursion or the movement of a muscle will be greater than the range of motion allowed by the joint. Basically, you have more length than what the joint will allow. It says, however, in a multi-joint muscle or two-joint or multi-joint, the muscle's ability to lengthen or excursion is going to be less than the combined range allowed by the joint. It was a fellow named Brunstrom. Brunstrom was one of these early, not an inventor, but early identifiers of the way the body moves. And Brunstrom came up with active and passive insufficiency to describe conditions in which a multi-joint muscle cannot either be shortened or lengthened far enough to allow all the joints that it will cross to move through their full range of motion. So let's make that make sense. I know you're looking at me with, like I have three heads. That's good, I'm okay with that. Gonna make it make sense. So let's go back to the shoulder girdle. So let's look at deltoid. So this is the deltoid muscle. This muscle you're looking at here, from here to about here and down to here, we'll call this muscle area here posterior deltoid. So posterior deltoid is responsible for making my shoulder go into shoulder extension. So when it contracts, when it shortens, when this piece of the muscle shortens from about here down to there, my arm does that. It has enough length to make sure that my arm gets all of the joint motion needed for shoulder extension. It's not going to shorten. It's not doing this. If there's nothing wrong with the muscle, it's going to give me abilities to get into my full range of motion. I get the full range. I get all of the motion that joint should allow. One joint muscle, when it contracts, it gives me all of the motion that joint should allow. Okay? So it does not have an insufficiency. Now let's go back and let's look at, well, let's do this. So deltoid, no insufficiency. All the motion that joint should allow. Now let's look at those hamstrings again. And now, when I look at the hamstring, because it is a two-joint muscle attaching to the hip and below the knee, when it contracts, it can only give me partial amounts of motion that the joint is supposed to occur when I am crossing both, well, I'm not crossing, when I am making it contract across both joints. So, active insufficiency says, let me make it make sense. So, active insufficiency says that range of motion will be limited. Motion is going to be limited across one or both joints when I'm contracting a two-joint muscle across both joints at the same time. Motion is going to be limited when I am contracting a joint across both, when I'm contracting a muscle across both joints that it crosses. Volunteer, please. Let's demo this. Yeah, it works. If you're breathing, come volunteer. All right, sir. Come have a lay down on your belly for me. Okay. So let's make this make sense. Can everybody see one way or the other? Good. Okay. So his knee has a certain degree of range of motion. So just being a knee. So you see that? Knee can actually touch. for his need. Now you try to bend it up for me. So actively, he gets about. So actively, he still has about that much range of motion. You see that? That's active. He can make it do that. But that's only because he's contracting his hamstrings at the knee. At the hip, they're relaxed. So he has much more motion because he's not having to contract his hamstrings across his hip with his knee. He's just doing it at the knee. So he has a whole lot more motion. Now, let's have him contract his hip. Well, let's do it this way. Let's do the hip. It'll be easier to see the hip, okay? So, try to, so now, this time we're gonna have him contract his hamstrings at his hip first. So contract the hamstring at the hip, lift them straight up, good. Hold that there, now try to bend your knee. See the difference in the joint angle? Now it looks like an L. At first he had it all the way up here. The reason why his knee doesn't bend any further is because when he contracted hamstrings across his hip, it limited the amount of contraction he could have done at the knee. That makes sense? The length is insufficient. So he's already contracting it at the hip. He's shortening it, pulling the muscle together at the hip. It's already engaged doing hip stuff. Now when you add in knee stuff, it doesn't have the length to give you full range of motion at both joints. So it is insufficient. That makes sense? So that's active insufficiency. I cannot contract a muscle fully across both joints when I am contracting the muscle across those two joints at the same time. I'm going to lose muscle strength and ability if I'm trying to contract a muscle across two different joints at the same time. That is active insufficiency. It's insufficient. It will not allow for him to do that across both joints. Okay with that? Nobody lost there. Okay. So passive insufficiency is going to be the opposite. So active insufficiency deals with muscle contraction. Hamstrings contract, bending the knee. Hamstrings contract. They're going to extend the hip. So that's contraction. Passive insufficiency deals with muscle lengthening. So instead of bending the knee, I would extend the knee to check for that. Instead of extending the hip, I would flex it. So flip on to your back for me. Let's demo passive insufficiency. Okay? So if I were going to stretch his hamstrings and I wanted to stretch them only across the hip, so I'm only looking at stretching hamstrings across his hip here. I don't want to stretch him across the knee and the hip, just the hip. Then the way I would do that is I would bend his knee. So if I were going to stretch hamstrings just at the hip, I would bend his knee and I would push him into hip flexion. So that's stretching hamstring at the hip, down on his butt cheek. You should feel that. Can you stretch there, sir? if I wanted to, now let's say I wanted to stretch hamstrings across both joints. So if I wanted to do both joints, not just at his hip, but his hip and his knee, I'm going to get substantially less motion out of both. That's stretching across hip and his knee. So his knee is straight, I'm stretching it. Instead of bending the knee, it's straight. Instead of extending the hip, I'm flexing it. So both are in opposite directions. When I do this, I get substantially less hip flexion than I did if I did this. So passive insufficiency says that I can't lengthen a muscle across both of his joints without there being limitations in how far the muscle will be elongated or be stretched. So active insufficiency, a muscle can't contract across both joints without reaching a point where it can't go any further. It can't contract any further across both joints, even though I'm not at the full range of motion. Passive insufficiency says I can't stretch a muscle at both joints and get full length at both joints. I'm going to lose some of the range of motion somehow. So, again, passive range of motion. So number four, range of motion will be limited across one or both joints when being stretched across those are how we rate active and passive insufficiencies. So one deals with the muscle being able to contract across both of its joints and the limitation. One deals with the muscle being able to be lengthened across both joints and it be hindered. Okay. Any questions? So the book has a great demonstration for passive insufficiency. So everybody stand. This will be an active demo. This is good. Okay. So, feet together. Be careful. You want to step back. Don't bump your head on the table. Yeah, turn sideways. It'll keep you from killing yourself. All right, so feet together. And the first thing you're going to do is you're going to keep your knees straight as possible and try to bend forward and touch your toes. All right. All you flexible people, you. There we go. with both. So, all right, come on up. So, that's a stretch for his hamstrings. His hips are moving into flexion, and his knees are staying into extension. His pelvis is doing this, which puts his hip into flexion. His knees are in extension, and he's bending over trying to stretch his hamstring. So, and it because his hamstrings are shortened or tight, they don't want to lengthen across the hip and the knee, so it limits his motion. So now, go back, same position for me. This time, we're going to do the same thing, but we're going to take the pressure off the knees. So we're instead of him stretching across the knees, we're going to bend the knees, which causes the hamstring to turn off at the knees, or causes them to be engaged at the knees so that they can't be stretched. And now we'll see if there's a difference in his ability. So let me bend a little bit more. There you go. So he bends all the way over. So that's a great way to think about passive insufficiency. When he engages hamstring at the knee instead of stretching it at the knee, so now because he's actively bending his knees, that can't stretch an active muscle. So now he's just stretching it at his hip, and it gives him substantially more motion. Thank you, sir. Okay. So that's what, when you look in your books, look on page 51. That's what the demo on page 51 is all about. So you'll see at first, figure A, that's the last thing we tried. So hamstrings were shortened at the knee, and they were being lengthened or stretched at the hip. He had more motion. But then when he tried to do C, lengthen them across both joints, it limited his range of motion. So now let's jump to page 52. We'll talk a little bit about stretching and then types of muscle contraction. And we'll probably wrap up by morning. Yep. Okay. So with stretching, it says generally speaking, when it uses the word agonist, you're thinking of the muscle that you're actually using. So the agonist is the muscle I am actively using. The muscle opposite of that on the other side of the joint is going to be called the antagonist. So when I'm doing elbow flexion, this motion, biceps will be an agonist, triceps on the other side of the joint are an antagonist. So it says, generally speaking, an agonist usually becomes insufficient or cannot contract any further because an antagonist becomes passively insufficient, meaning it cannot be stretched any further. So when I can't stretch any further, it's going to limit how much motion I'm going to have. So I have to make sure I am able to turn off my don't worry about that. Just know passive insufficiency can affect active movement. That's what I want you to take from that. Okay. I don't want to go too deep into that. We're going to get more into it as we go deeper into this class. Okay, lastly, types of muscle contractions. The book says that there are three basic types of muscle contractions. I kind of disagree. There's really only two. The third one is a machine assist. So I really can't call it a muscle contraction because the machine assisted. Does it make any sense? So that's like saying, I am super strong, but I have bionic arms. My physical strength would be a whole lot less if I didn't have the bionic arms. So same thing. The two major type of muscle contractions are isometric and isotonic. Isometric and isotonic. Isometric contraction is when the joint, there is going to be muscle contraction, but there is no joint movement. So isometric again, muscle contraction, but no joint movement. We see this all the time. So everybody take your right arm, put your left arm on top of it, down by the wrist, and you're gonna push down with this one to the same amount of force that you're using to pull up with this one. And now pull up and push down. Is there any joint motion? It's staying about the same. Okay, the reason there's no joint motion is because the force that you're pushing down with equals the force of the force you're pushing up with. So even though I have muscle contraction, there is no active movement. Same way if I tried to push down this wall. So if I was standing here and I tried to push over this wall, I'm contracting my muscles, but the wall isn't being pushed down. So the type of muscle contraction I have is an isometric. So I'm exerting force, but the joint angle doesn't change. Isotonic is actually going to be joint angle changing contractions, and there are two different types. I have a concentric type of isotonic, and I have an eccentric type of isotonic. Let's make them both make sense. So concentric is the way we think about joints normally. So if I have any time I am moving and I am shortening the joint, I'm using the muscle, I'm bringing my insertion closer to my origin, that's going to be an isotonic contraction. Okay? So I'm bringing my insertion closer to my origin. That is an isotonic contraction. Okay. So, I'm here, and I'm curling this. So I want to work bicep. Working biceps today. I want to do biceps. So if I am doing something where I am moving my insertion, so bicep inserts here on the forearm, it originates here in the shoulder. So if I want to work bicep, I am going to do this for concentric. I'm going to move my insertion closer to my origin. There. So insertion is now closer to the origin. That's a concentric contraction. Make sense? Shortening the joint angle, bringing my insertion closer to my origin. insertion away from the origin back to the start position. So I start at the closed position, and now I'm slowly moving the weight back to my start position, still engaging the muscle. That's called eccentric contraction. When I'm moving the insertion, I'm moving the insertion away from the origin back to neutral position.
But the muscle is still contracting.
But the same muscle is still contracting. Yes. So not using a different muscle, same muscle contracts. So let's practice this so you can get a feel for it. Okay, everybody turn your chair sideways, either direction. We're gonna do concentric, eccentric leg work. So we're gonna do concentric quadricep work. So concentric, so quads start on the upper thigh or the pelvis. They insert here below the knee. So if I'm doing concentric, if I'm trying to move this closer to this, what motion would I do? Very good. Knee extension. Kicking somebody.
Whack.
Swinging the knee. So that is a concentric quadricep exercise. I'm extending my knee. Good stuff. Everybody able to do it? Nobody has any trouble. That's easy. I like it. Concentric we love. Okay? Now let's do some eccentric quads. So everybody stand. So stay near your chair. You're going to need it. So what you're going to do is spread your feet slightly. And you're going to lower yourself down into your chair, but we're going to do it for a count of 10. Slowly. All right, here we go. On three. One, two, three. I'm going to count. Don't you count yourself. I count. All right, ready? Go. One, two, three, four, five, six. Whose quads are burning? Feel those quads burning? Ah, 7, 8, 9, hold it. 10. All right, yeah, baby. Woo! All right. How many of you felt the muscle on the top of your thighs burning? Felt your quads burn? Like, good gosh, he's the slowest counting human on earth. Hurry up. The reason was that was eccentric quad strengthening. So that lowering of yourself down onto the chair, your quad muscle is actually moving, it's actually working in that way to help lower you down, eccentric. So that's what's doing the work. That's why your quads were screaming. Oh my gosh. Then if you pull yourself back up, that's concentric quad. So eccentric is I am still contracting the same muscle, but instead of moving my insertion toward my origin, I'm moving my origin towards my insertion. So when you go to squat, you're moving your hips closer to your knees versus moving your knee. Ooh, good God, that scared the life out of me. Instead of moving your knee closer to your hip. Make sense? That's eccentric versus concentric. Okay? Any questions? Okay, the last one is called isokinetics. So isokinetics is actually machine-assisted range of motion. It's not something you can do on your own. It has its purposes. Usually we use it a lot for things like muscle testing or strengthening type things. But for the most part, isokinetics is not a true contraction. So page 56. So it's actually referring to the speed of a contraction and not contraction itself. So it's not a true contraction exercise. So, all right, so this is a good video here showing you how an isokinetic testing works. It's usually done with a Biodex machine. So the big burly machine is called a Biodex. It's usually connected to a computer and it's measuring your force output at different speed levels. And it's able to provide resistance in both directions and get a measurement of how much force you're using. So it's really a force input output. And it's good for determining what's going on with the body.
Drinking water before bed burns 46 pounds in 2 weeks. If you are struggling to lose weight and you're over 25, then you need to hear this. People are burning 2.5 pounds of fat each night as they sleep by adding this one ingredient to their glass of water before bed. Harvard scientists confirmed for the first time ever that weight gain problems have nothing to do with your metabolism speed, diet, or...
Just 3 in the hamstrings muscle. Today's laboratory activity will involve the Biodex Isokinetics muscle testing system. We've used this system for teaching basic muscle function concepts in our exercise physiology and exercise testing laboratories. We've used this to test some of our Coastal Carolina University athletes. They've also used that for rehabilitation. We use this machine to look at muscle imbalances, not only from right side of the body towards the left side of the body, but also opposing muscle groups within a limb. For example, quadriceps in the front of the thigh to the hamstrings in the back. And what we've found in the research has shown that when there are imbalances between those muscle groups, that leads to an increase in rate of anterior cruciate ligament tears, for example. So we can use this system to test not only knee strength, but many other muscle groups and limbs as well. All right, guys, we're going to do an isokinetic test on Zach. So the first thing we need to do is strap Zach down so that we can isolate the muscle groups that we're going to be testing, his quadriceps and hamstrings. So go ahead and bring the straps around over his shoulders and upper body. And we want those to be kind of snug. All right, now we're setting him up to test his left leg, but what are some other values of isokinetics testing? Why would we test the left leg versus the right leg in multiple muscle groups? What are some of the values of isokinetics testing?
To see the difference between the two legs, if one's weaker than the other, if they've had an injury.
Right, if there's a muscle imbalance between one leg or the other with an injured limb, we really don't know how strong his limb was before the injury, so what we do is we compare the injured limb to his healthy limb. That way we have an idea of a starting point and how far we would want to go. And why would we want to test the strength of his quadriceps, muscles in front, versus hamstrings in the back? What would a muscle imbalance on one side of the limb versus the other potentially do?
Can cause injury if there's an imbalance between the two of them?
Yeah, so for example, anterior cruciate ligament tears, one of the most common knee injuries that we see in athletics, are in many cases caused by a muscle imbalance between the quadriceps and the hamstrings. So we're going to test both of those movements or both of those muscle groups at multiple speeds. So the first thing that we're going to do is set his range of motion.
Okay.
Let's hold it right there. Just hold it right about there. Another thing we're going to do is test you at multiple speeds. We're going to test you at very fast speeds and very slow speeds. And as we've talked about in class with the force-velocity relationship, if we're doing a muscle lift or a maneuver at a very slow speed, we would expect that your force production is going to be relatively high. As we increase the speed of the movement, there's less time to recruit motor units and muscle fibers into that action, so we would gradually see the force production drop off the faster the speed we go. So hopefully we can see that demonstrated on the screen here. And we're going to be starting out at a medium speed, probably about 60 degrees per second, somewhere in that range. Okay, so go ahead and take your leg all the way back and wait for the signal. Go. Pull back. Kick. Pull. Kick. Pull. Good job. Come on, Zach. Last one. Okay, just relax.
And that amount of resistance to every kick and pull, and it's measuring his force output using the computer there. So as he's kicking, it's measuring the force output from the kick, and then as he pulls, it measures the force output from his pull. And so that's what isokinetic does. So it looks at movement with speed, but it's machine-based. And it's good if you're doing athletics. Very rarely do you see these machines anymore in clinic. Have any of you ever seen this machine before? Never in your life, so yeah. There may be one or two of them actually still left in a clinic somewhere. Very rarely are you going to see them anymore. People just don't do a lot of biodex testing on general population. More going to be seen with athletes. You'll see it a lot more with them. Okay? Any questions about that?
Crap.
It's already. Alrighty. So, take a break there. We'll come back. We'll hit a couple more things in chapter 5. And then we're going to hit chapter 6 with the breeze. Then we'll be on to test 1.